always has had its chance to rule. And we're in the last dispensation before Jesus comes and wipes out all of governments and sets up his millennial reign, his millennial government. Two of them got murdered. One down south, one got murdered here. And whatever is done in dark is coming to the light. So you can't turn to someone and say, you just can't do it. It will catch up with you. This is why the Bible is speaking to the conduct of the Christian apostolic disciple. There's certain conduct, brothers and sisters. I mean, I've been to D.C. many times. I remember when we D.C. on one occasion, I was riding in a limousine that we had rented because we were going to meet Michael Powell, who was the FCC director. I was with Judge Helen Brown's brother, who is the head of a corporation, Brown Consulting, whatever they call it, that Marty Nystrom works for. And we were riding, and the man said to me, he said, now tonight, what are you doing tonight? I said, well, I'm going back to my room like I always do. I said, well, I have a ticket to the strip joint. This nice lady's waiting over there. I said, no. I mean, no, it's free. This is on me. I said, no. I said, because with my luck, the newspaper will be there waiting to take a picture of me, and I'll be on the front page, and then my bishop would disfellowship me from the PAW. I said, what I would better do is you just take me back to my room. We went and got something to eat. And as I always said, I went back to my room. No one can trace me to any scandal.
That's right.
No one can trace me because I've not been involved in any such thing. And I'm saying that to say that, you know, these things can catch up with you. I have an expense account. I have a credit card. I've been all over the world. But you can investigate until your eyeballs fall out. You won't trace me to any scandal. And I just never have been in it. And I'm not trying to say I'm holier than nobody. I'm not trying to say that when I've gone places I haven't had thoughts. I've had many thoughts. Can the church say amen? But I've been fortunate to avoid corruption and scandal. And I'm saying that to say God is pulling the cover off of these things because the scripture said he would. The facts are coming out. The truth and the facts are two different things. The facts are what happened. The truth is what determines what is right and what is wrong with respect to what happened. So they keep saying, you need to tell the truth. No, you need to tell the facts. Then we use the truth to condemn your behavior. Can the church say amen? There is a difference. There is a difference. Because if the laws change for the person to express what they've done and the laws make right wrong and wrong right, and people say tell the truth, you can be claiming right is wrong and wrong is right. You're not telling the truth. You're stating facts which are a lie. So the truth is the word of God. The facts are what you present concerning your conduct or the details of the circumstances and the situation that you or I have been involved in. Give us the facts. And we can go to the scripture and say whether or not your conduct is right or it is wrong according to the what? The truth, the scripture, the truth. This is the truth. Can the church say amen? All right, now in verse number 27, this is what we want. Read. Neither give place to who?
The devil.
Read on. Let him that stole steal no more. Turn to someone and say, you have no business stealing. Read. But rather let him labor, working with his hands, the things which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. So you work so you can take care of yourself. You work so also you can help others. Here is your scripture. I work to take care of myself. I work to help others. There are some that are in need. I do have an obligation to help when I can. And all the people said, this is the scripture we want. Read. Let's read. But let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. So this is what we're talking about. Someone said speak. We're talking about speaking. The voice of the Christian. The voice of the parishioner. The voice of the child of God should be under the governance of the Holy Spirit. And the word of God should govern what we say. And when people hold their peace when they should, then God can intervene. And when people speak when they should, then God can intervene and God can be glorified. This is a continuation of the subject we just taught on last week. Then they that feared the Lord spoke often one to another, and the Lord hearkened unto them and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written unto them. God is hearing our speech. God is where we are. God is in our circumstances. God is in our midst. God is in us. Christ in you, the hope of glory. So trying to act like we are some far removed deist, because deism says God exists, but he's not involved. I'm not no deist. Turn to someone and say, I'm not no deist, brother. I'm sanctified. God is involved in my life. Now, he may not be involved in your life, but he's involved in mine. He may not be with you, but he's with me. He may not be on your side, but he's on my side, and I'm on his side. This should be the disposition of the apostolic Christian. Someone say the apostolic Christian. So when you speak, verse number 30, read, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Look at verse number 31. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. So again, this is dealing with, someone say, my speech. You have to be careful about what comes out of your mouth. You cannot act as though there is, you have no control over it, because you and I have the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So cursing and swearing and lying and saying stuff that doesn't make any sense, all you're doing and all I would be doing is putting myself in a position for God to either chastise me or the wrath of God to come upon me. Can we say amen? You have to be careful. There's a seven, in the seventh chapter of St. Matthew, I think it is. Is that the one that says, judge not lest ye be? Is that Matthew chapter 7? Isn't that Matthew chapter 7? For with judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with measure you meet, it shall be what? Is that Matthew 7 or St. John 7? That's Matthew 7. I'm quoting that, but you can look at that particular scripture. Jesus spoke that. And this is what Mr. Governor Elliot Spitzer should realize. With what judgment he put on people, oh, you can believe it. It's coming back. Touch someone and say, it's coming back, child. When you put something on somebody and you're in authority and you judge a person as such, it's coming back. Even though I'm digressing here, he went after a lot of Republicans. I'm sorry I had to put it like that. And he went after a lot of Democrats. And he was a Democrat. And now the judgment he judged is back on him. And I watched some of the interviews. I said, they're going to get him. They're moving to impeach him right now. They said, oh, they're going to get him, because what he did is he used his power to get everybody he could to make himself look like he was above the fray. And all along, he was a hypocrite.
Right.
See, I just don't want to talk about, well, I might be a hypocrite. Well, shame on you. I'm saying, just because you may be a hypocrite, that doesn't mean you give a hypocrite a pass. I'm sorry to have to say it like this. The man was a horrible hypocrite for him to do what he did. I tracked his life. He was out of order. Turn to someone and say, that Negro was out of order. Now, he's not a Negro. I'm just being facetious there. Our brothers from WashU, God bless you. I'm simply trying to get us to think that this behavior ultimately catches up with people. When we violate the what? You violate the scriptures, it catches up with whoever we are. Can the church say amen? Amen. All right, so let all bitterness, verse 31, and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. These are things we need to get out of our spirit so it doesn't come out of our what? Our mouth. So we're not saying things because the Bible says in another place, every idle word man shall speak, he shall give an account of in the day of judgment. Therefore, let your words be few. Let your conversation be yes, yes, and no, no. A wise person studies to be quiet. A wise person. Amen. But sometimes, turn to someone and say, but sometimes I have to speak. Well, if you speak, verse 32 read, and be ye kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. If you speak, have a Christ-like demeanor and disposition. And avoid all of this nonsense of arguing, fussing, cursing and swearing, and using all this hostile engagement, because you know unless you are actually on a mission from God, speaking to a person to try to correct them so they will do what God said do. And even that, it says, let your speech be what? Let's go to the book of Galatians. I'll show it to you. Galatians chapter 6, I think it is. Is it Galatians 6? Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how to answer what? Is that Galatians or is that Colossians?
It's Colossians.
Colossians what? Now, don't say it's Colossians. You got it. Let your speech be always with what? Grace. You found it yet? You go to Galatians chapter 6. Let your speech be always with what? Grace. Where's my Bible scholars? Colossians 4 and 6. Colossians 4 and 6. For the trip, I thought you'd find that scripture, but you're walking around. All right. Here it is. Someone say speech. Read again. Colossians 4 and 6. Read. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Grace means showing unmerited favor. Grace means showing favor a person does not deserve. They really deserve for you to be a bit harsher. Another scripture says in 15th chapter of Proverbs, a soft answer turneth away wrath. Grievous words stir up anger. So a lot of times people don't understand when they are able to speak with grace, they're able to diffuse a situation that could turn violent. The woman that talked to the guy who shot in Atlanta, the man who shot the judge and shot the police officer, then he was on the run, then he came in contact with the white girl in the apartment complex. She said she smoked crack with him, I think it was, and had a nice conversation with him. He calmed down, turned himself in. Now, I'm not saying that she should have smoked crack. I'm not, don't get me wrong, brothers back there, though. I'm just saying the woman's speech was with grace, or it was, she engaged him on a level of tranquility. Somehow, I guess she was supposed to be reading Rick Warren's book, wasn't she? So they were getting high and reading the book or something, and she was reading Rick Warren's book, A Purpose-Driven Life, because that's when his book went off the charts. He sold all these millions of books because she was reading this book. And then Rick Warren runs over and claims to be her pastor, and then he found out what level she was engaged with him on, and he backed away. But the girl was just trying to keep from getting killed, praise the Lord. She just did what she had to do to try to survive. So I'm saying that she, in her own testimony, said that she engaged him with very soft speech. She talked to him. She didn't get hostile. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. But for the Christian, we need to follow the word of what? God. Now, if you're casting devils out of somebody, you have to raise your voice. Can the church say amen? Amen. You have to say, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you, Satan, to come out. But we're talking about having basic communication with people we come in contact with. Speaking these things that Scripture calls for us to speak, allowing our hearts to be governed by. Someone say the Holy Spirit. All right, let us go now to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. No. 1 Timothy. We're over here in the Old Testament. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. I want you to see speech. The Bible is speech, is it not? The Bible is written speech. They spoke it and wrote it. They wrote it and we speak it. They wrote it and we preach it. They wrote it and we expound it. They wrote it and we teach it. I'm speaking it. Multitudes of ministers are speaking it in churches all over the country, throughout the world. When I went to Venezuela, we spoke through an interpreter the word of God, and 61 people received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking with other tongues and the Spirit of God gives utterance. We simply spoke the gospel. I spoke in English. The interpreter spoke in Spanish, and the Spanish people who did not speak in English spoke in other tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance when God gave them the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So this thing is very serious communication. Question is, how in fact would we be able to move and engage on the level that we are interacting on today in modern society if it wasn't for speech? Communication, the voice, the words that God is the author of. Because remember now, in the beginning, God created and God said. The first one to speak was God. The first one to have a voice was God. The first one to express a thought and then manifest his thought and bring to bear all these things that we're upheld by. For the scripture says he upholds all things by the word of his power. So we're simply existing because of the speech of God. Because God spoke, we are here today, sitting up in here, and we'll leave here, get in our cars, we'll go and engage, make money, buy things, enjoy and manage and execute a quality of life, all because God spoke. And because of what he spoke, is carrying the day for each of our individual lives for as long as we're here. And we will meet him in the end and receive our rewards for what it is that he has ordained the purpose of our life to do. Turn to someone and say, heavy artillery. The first epistle of Paul, the apostle, to Timothy, chapter 4, verse 1. Let's read. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly. Someone say, speaketh. This is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit speaks. I am teaching tonight under the influence of the Holy Spirit. I'm reading what the Holy Spirit speaks. The Apostle Paul said, now the Spirit speaketh, continues to speak expressly. What? That in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, and so on and so forth. That's all we have to read. But these are things the Spirit warns us. So sometimes we have to warn our children. We have to warn the members of our church. We have to warn the churches in our diocese. We have to warn the pastors of the churches in our diocese. Sometimes we have to speak to warn as the Holy Spirit has spoken. And I'm simply saying to people, when you are supposed to be speaking or you're given the responsibility and the authority to speak, and you don't speak to your children, you don't express to your children warnings that need to be expressed to them. The preacher doesn't express to his congregation warnings that need to be expressed concerning the pitfalls and the deception and the various doctrines and things that are being proliferated to deceive those who may be simple-minded. When bishops don't express these things and speak these things to the pastors in their diocese.
Right.
Then individuals go unwarned because they don't know. And my peer, the scripture says in the 5th chapter of the book of Hosea, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge because they have rejected knowledge. Does someone want to say, I need to know, I need to know, I need to know? We do need to know. Verse 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 4. I'm sorry, the first epistle of John chapter 4. I'm trying to give you some scripture. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
I speak, Sister Cecily will come down. She'll speak about the Holy Spirit. Those that believe, 15th chapter of the book of Acts says, he giveth the Holy Ghost to them that obey him. So those that believe and obey, they will receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. All because a person was under the influence of the Holy Spirit and spoke as the Holy Spirit inspired them. And all the people said, thank you for finally doing that. In 1 John, because that's what our ushers are supposed to do. 1 John verses 1 and 2. And 3. Let's read out loud together. 1 Epistle of John chapter 4 verses 1 through 3. Let's read. Beloved. Everybody shout beloved. Believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Verse 2. Hereby know ye the spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. So if a preacher or so-called prophet is supposed to be representing God, they will be preaching that Jesus Christ is God come in the flesh. He's the Son of God in the flesh. Or he's God in the flesh in the office of the sonship. However you want to put it. The Spirit, if it's of God, is going to preach Jesus. It's not going to preach oil. Someone say, it ain't going to be the oil man. It's not going to be preaching blessings, selling blessed water, blessed oil, blessed hands, and this. They will preach Jesus if they are of God, because Jesus is the Son of God, and he's also God manifest in the flesh. Are you listening to me? So here is your scripture. Verse 2, read, hereby know ye the Spirit of God, every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is of God. Verse 2, and every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's just that simple. If they bring any other doctrine, any other God, any other salvation, any other way, it's not of God. So you can hold your peace if you don't have an opportunity to say anything, or if you have the Holy Ghost, you have an obligation to introduce Jesus. You can be polite. You don't have to argue with them, say, you're going to hell saying that. You're demon-possessed. You don't have to do that. But you do have to tell them, no, let me express to you, the Holy Spirit is real.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit is Jesus Christ himself. That's my experience. All I can do is share with you my experience. And leave it at that. Praise the Lord. You don't have to turn to someone and say, you don't have to start choking people. Just tell them about who? Jesus Christ. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't choke anybody. Every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. Read, and this is the spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. So what you're dealing with here is you're dealing with false prophets in verse number one. Some who are not false, who are saying that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Those who are false are saying he did not come in the flesh, or that he is not God and or the Son of God. You're hearing them speak these things. By what they speak, it's revealing who they are. It's revealing where they're from just by listening to what they say. Can the church say amen? Amen. And if this is not enough, then verse number 4 and 5, let's finish reading then. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is where? In the world. So it's he that is in you, who is the Spirit of God. It's he that is in the world that does not have the Spirit of God. Next verse. They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. So we have to deal with this issue of what we are hearing, what people are saying, and what we don't have to hear when it is not of God. There's just some things you don't have to hear. And when you're being upset by things people say, when you have no business listening to it anyway. When we're being influenced by what people say, when we have no business being influenced by it anyway. This falls squarely on our shoulders and within the purview of our responsibility. Praise the Lord. Verse number 6, let's read this now. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. I don't know how we can get any clearer than that. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
I'm almost finished here. Let's go to Psalms 140 quickly. I'm trying to give you some good scripture here tonight so you can go home. You ponder. Turn to someone and say, ponder these things, please. Ponder, ponder, ponder. Psalms 140 and verse 11. I'll give you the scripture again. Speech and what people are saying can hurt and destroy a lot of people. And all the people said, let's read this real quickly. Verse number 11, read. Let not an evil speaker be established in the earth. Now look at me for a moment. Someone say Adolf Hitler. Someone say Benito Mussolini. Someone say Idi Amin. Someone say Slobodan Milosevic. Someone say Saddam Hussein. People in leadership who had authority, who gave their voice and massacred hundreds and thousands and millions of people. They didn't do it. Their speech did it. They were elevated in authority and they gave a decree with their mouth and wiped out thousands of generations. And we don't weigh these things. We don't think about this. You watch Hitler on television speaking, you can hear the voice of the devil. If you have any Holy Spirit, I've watched those History Channel. I watched him speak. I said, look at the devil talking. And thousands of people worshiping and chanting. Because an evil speaker was where? Established in the earth. When the Antichrist comes, he will be an evil speaker established in the earth. And as it says here, evil shall hurt the violent man to overthrow him. All of them ultimately were what? Overthrown because of their evil and their violence. But in the interim, in the transition, multitudes of innocent people did what? Lost their lives, did they not? During the civil rights movement, evil people were in power. Violence was perpetrated against African Americans. But remember, African Americans perpetrated violence against white people when Pharaoh was in office. Because every race has had its chance to rule. And we're in the last dispensation before Jesus comes and wipes out all of governments and sets up his millennial reign, his millennial government. So black folks have abused white folks, and Red folks have abused yellow folks.